The only bill that will be heard today will be House Resolution 1 by Petrie. The others have been, we're holding them. Just one for more information. One has a sub that didn't get to the committee in time. In just a second.
Where do you want me to?
Just sit right here. That you're going to be in, you're on the program. Okay, thank you for being here. Come on up, Courtney. Are you trying to get the answer? Okay, so appreciate y'all's flexibility. This is the world we're in at times, and I'm sorry it took us. There's no apologies. It's just the way it is. We're glad you're here now. Welcome you. I just always thought, you know, are any teachers that are here today with us? No active teachers. I know you got one right there raising her hand. Where are you a teacher at? Okay, you're ready. Okay, gotcha. Well, there are a whole bunch of them here today. You just talking to us on the rope line, and I don't know if any of them stayed around. I know there are a bunch from Camden County in my office this morning. We sure do appreciate the work that they do. I'm going to start us off with a little word of prayer, and then we'll take off. Bow our heads, please. Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us be together and, you know, help us doing great work for the children of Georgia. Please look over us. Keep us safe in this weather. Please look after Chairman Lynn Smith's husband. We really offer a prayer up for her and him. And please look after us. Bless us in your name. Amen. Okay, just a couple of housekeeping things, members. You know, we had a little confusion the other day in a subcommittee meeting. Do look at the list that's on there, and especially on the in your book of which subcommittee you're on. Certainly want any committee member to come to a subcommittee. And, you know, and I'm okay, Mr. Chairman, with any member in it to talk and ask questions, because that's where we're going to do it at. And so please let any member talk. Now, but voting in the subcommittees is by membership, and we'll hold that pretty strict. Now, today was a perfect example of why my intern is sitting right here. Now, Macon is a millennial. And Macon.
I'm actually a Gen Z. I'm sorry.
Oh, excuse me. Gen Z.
Sorry, I know that's worse.
I don't know. I don't know. I think it's pretty cool because you're such a valuable part of our team. And we appreciate Macon a lot. So, and today's the perfect example that we've run behind, and it's hard to notify everybody. We tried texting, and so Macon says, Mr. Chairman, we had this thing in high school we did, and it was perfect. And I will turn it over to our intern, Macon, and she's going to explain Remind 101. Huh? You're 21? Oh, I put it's 22. Sorry. Thank you, ma'am. Go get it.
Hi, everybody. I'm Macon, like he said. And so this is just for the committee. In your folders, it's the first page, there should be a short little information sheet. It says Remind 101 instructions on the top. It's very simple. All you have to do is text the bolded phrase that starts with the @ to the italicized number, and it'll start. You'll have to type in your name if you haven't used it before. It'll ask you if you're a student or a teacher or a parent, and you can say whatever you want because it doesn't matter. We're not using it for school. So it'll then create a separate text thread, and you'll get messages from me and Chairman Jaspers about meeting times, if it gets changed or pushed back. So that way we don't have any more confusion, and it's quick and easy to do. And you can also reply to the thread. But instead of it getting sent out to the entire group, it'll go directly to Chairman Jaspers for ease of communication. So there's a full committee phrase, an academic achievement phrase, an academic support phrase, and an academic innovation phrase. So just if you could go ahead and do that, please. And if you have any questions, I'm in 218 all the time.
She'll hang around. I think Vice Chairman Chokas just handed her his phone.
He said, you can do it. I said, okay.
So I'm going to put my phone under the desk. So I hope that will help, you know, just communicating, you know, because it gets busy, especially the next 2 weeks. We'll have a number of meetings and subcommittee meetings. I think that will help a lot. I'd be glad, you know, if you have any feedback on it, talk to Macon. But we appreciate you, Macon, for helping us out with that, for sure.
Happy to do it.
Okay, with our order, we're going to do the Representative Petrie's bill, and go ahead and do that one first, and then we'll have a speaker. So, Representative Petrie, would you come up to the center, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I think this will be the easiest bill you will see all year, and indeed, this bill you passed out of here last year, and we never got it out of rules. It is LC 337500. Does everybody have that one before you? If so, what this bill is very simple. We have an extremely successful, as I think everyone here knows better than I do, Georgia Special Needs Scholarship in this state, and has been a tremendous success. I serve in my real job a great deal of individuals with developmental disabilities, and this scholarship has been a blessing to so many families. Senator Eric Johnson from Savannah, from my hometown, actually way back in the day, before it was cool to even talk about choice in education, supported this legislation. It was our first foray really into providing any kind of meaningful choice. He strongly supported this, and I think everyone agrees this has been an enormous blessing to so many families with children with developmental disabilities. My intention here is to simply change the name of what is now the Georgia Special Needs Scholarship Act to the Senator Eric Johnson Scholarship Act, and the scholarship going forward would be known as the Senator Eric Johnson Scholarship. Pretty simple, Mr. Chairman.
Very simple. And yeah, we all, most of us heard that. Any committee members have a question for Chairman? Hear none. Did they hear a motion? Motion second. Oh, you got a question? Well, just push that button. Oh, not till late.
You were moving fast.
Well, I'm moving fast. These people have been waiting. And you have been too. Go ahead, Ms. Story.
Simple question.
Yes, ma'am.
He clearly must have preceded my time. Who is Senator Eric Johnson?
Yes. Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you for asking that. So, Senator Eric Johnson is a former senator from Savannah, from Chatham County, who has now for quite some time been retired. He was the Senate pro tem. He was the, how do we say that, Chairman? He was pro tem of the Senate, was his title. And so he was just a great guy, someone that's widely regarded in Savannah, well-respected. And I just thought this was a fitting thing to do since he has long since retired from politics. But thank you for your question.
So, and I guess...
Okay, hold on.
Okay.
What's the right procedure?
Okay. May I do a follow-up?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I guess I was just asking, like, I was thinking that you were asking to change the scholarship to his in his honor because maybe he had done something in this area of education. That's the only reason why. Because, you know, somebody else may want it to be something else. I think
over his many years of service, he did a lot of things for education. But I guess the one I'm trying to recognize most is this one. This was a tremendous success in education that I'm trying to recognize. Yes, ma'am. That's correct.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Questions? All in favor? Aye. Pardon? We have a second. All sorts of people down through there. Just a second. We got plenty. Yeah. She had to write down who. Okay. Moving too quick. I'm sorry. We have all in favor. Aye. Any opposed? No. Blackstone. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And
appreciate
thank you,
the work he did. Okay, one little bit of cleanup, or it's not really. We're going to sign a bill that was put in committee, H.R. 791, to academic support. Notify everybody of that one. So for just in a part of our education, Ms. Helen Sloat, was she here? She's going to introduce some speakers who'd just like to tell us a little about what they're doing. And if y'all come to the center, we'll just let you speak. I know a lot of people got to come and go, and that's why we kind of did our order just a little bit differently.
I'm Helen Slate with Nelson Mullins, and I'm here on behalf of Together Georgia, and I have a number of folks here that are going to speak to you about the residential treatment facilities. I'm going to let them each introduce themselves.
Good afternoon. My name is Allison Evans, and I am the CEO and president of the Methodist Home for Children and Youth located in Macon, Georgia. I'm also here representing as the chairman of Together Georgia, which is a statewide association of providers who deal with children within the child welfare system. Some familiar names to you might be Georgia Baptist Children's Home, Twin Cedars, also doing business as Georgia Industrial Children's Home, Devereaux, Hillside, Murphy Harpst, Morning Star in Glynn County. So we want to share with you a little bit about what residential treatment facilities are. Most of them are nonprofit organizations that deal with children that are placed with us through DBHDD, the Department of Health and Developmental Disabilities, Department of Children and Families, or Department of Juvenile Justice. And some children are placed with us by their families, especially in some of our psychiatric residential treatment facilities. Most of these kids have very, very aggressive behaviors, including defiance, sexual acting out, developmental issues, and often have co-occurring medical conditions. One of the reasons why the children that we educate in these residential treatment facilities, we want to educate them on campus, is because of safety factors. You can have a child who has an extreme outburst of violent behavior, and the teachers and therapists involved in our centers and sites have had extensive training to be able to deal with that. So the health and well-being and the safety of our community is very important to this as these children learn to control their behaviors. We are the psychiatric residential treatment facilities are serving children who are there because of medical necessity. And then there's child care institutions like the Methodist Home, and we are licensed by the Department of Human Services. And some organizations actually have both of these types of children on our campuses. We are regulated by all sorts of licensing bodies as well as national accreditation, both for our child care institutions, but also educationally. We are accredited by Advanced Ed, which is formerly known as SACS. In fact, on the Methodist Home campus, which is Price Education, we had two reviewers, independent educators, who came to look at our programs, and they said that the services, the psychosocial and educational services for our kids were phenomenal. And they had never seen a school so strongly embedded with the behavioral health support that these children needed that then created better opportunities for their learning. Most of our facilities are 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and include other therapy services, mental health services, equine therapy, play therapy, or whatever might be appropriate for the children that we are serving. We serve children from all ages, but most schools are very specific. So, for instance, my school serves children between the ages of third grade to eighth grade. But there might be other organizations or institutions that serve high school students. They are oftentimes, they may be gender specific as well. So we have a program on our campus called the STARS program, which deals with boys between the ages of 6 and 12, where the exposure that they have had to either sexual abuse or significant pornography has so much been embedded in their bodies and in their brains that they do not know how to be appropriate around other kids their age and may have acted out against those kids. And so that's why they need to be in a specialized educational program. I want to tell you about a little boy real quickly before I turn it over. I'm not going to use his name, but he's a little tornado. He's about this tall. And within 48 hours of coming to our campus, and our school seats 30 children, everybody on our campus, all the adults and all the other children, 80 plus, that live there, they knew him by name. Because that little tornado had kind of come in, and we had broken windows, and we had torn up furniture, and we had all kinds of things. But he settled down, and he did a really good job. And his principal said, you know, Allison is truly amazing. I'm not sure anybody has ever praised him for positive behaviors and positive academic growth because they've only seen the little tornado behavior. We were able to keep him for a year in our program and got him graduated to the next grade level. He spent the summer with us. This year, his tornado grew, and he became a big tornado. And unfortunately, he got beyond our scope and capacity to care for and likely went to one of those psychiatric residential treatment facilities. His tornado isn't his fault. It's what's going on inside him and what's churning inside of him. But I would plead his case saying that if he had been in a regular school system, he'd have had frequent flyer miles down to the principal's office or the detention center instead of progressing forward with another year of passing in his grades. So when you think about dealing with the residential treatment centers, either within the budget, within the system, we want you to know that we are caring with these for these fragile children, and we are so thankful for your support. I'm going to now introduce to you Dr. Christina Kennedy, who's one of the principals for one of the schools at one of our sites.
Hi, my name is Christina, and I am the education director at Hillside, and we are here in Atlanta, part of Atlanta Public School System, and we are one of the psychiatric residential treatment centers. So we take the highest level of care with our children, and they're the highest needs kids in the state. So the type of kids that we get are children that have multiple disability categories. They can be bipolar, depressed. The majority of children that come to Hillside have tried to commit suicide, and they come straight to us from the short-term hospitals because they're not safe to go home. So we do very much specialize in the types of treatment that we provide at the different facilities. We also have children that have schizophrenia. They may have autism. We have a lot of anxiety. Kids that are not successful in the regular school setting. Many of our kids come to us and they have not been in school for months because they have such high anxiety that they cannot go sit in a school building with other kids. So they're unable to be in the traditional settings. The residential treatment facilities are addressed in code OCGA 20-2-133. There are about 20 residential schools in the state of Georgia, and at any given time, we might be serving 700 to 800 students in our schools. As you said, all of our schools are accredited through SACS or Advanced Ed or some other accrediting agency, so we're all independently accredited and not just through our local school system. So we have all gone through a very strenuous process to ensure that we're providing the top level of care for our kids as far as the education piece goes. We do all have memorandums of understanding with our local school systems that we have to sign off on each year saying what they will provide, what we will do, but we all have to meet the same level of accreditation, of reporting, of testing, everything that a regular public school has to do, we have to do the same thing. So our kids take the milestones, even if they're not even safe to be in the building, they have to take the milestones, which is something I have an issue with, but we'll talk about that another time. So we're having to do the same things. Our teachers have to be highly qualified, they have to be certified, generally in multiple areas, because they may be teaching middle school science one week. 2 weeks later, the majority of our kids are high school, and it's, hey, guess what? Can you teach high school lit? So you have to be highly qualified in just about everything and flexible to move depending on our population at the time. Our length of stays differ from facility to facility. It really depends on the type of kids that we get. So we may have students in a facility for a year, sometimes 2 years when I first started a long time ago. And then now with some of my high school kids, they may be with us 30 to 45 days. So our transiency is a huge issue that we have to address all the time. We all offer some type of summer programming. We do our best to keep the kids engaged, because if they're not engaged in having a structured day, then that's where the thoughts start to come in, the trauma starts to come back. So we try to make sure that our kids are academically engaged and engaged in therapeutic recreational activities all summer long as well. We all employ tutors to make sure that they're getting an even extra layer of academics if they need it, because many of our kids come in very far behind academically. We might have high school kids that really can't even read at an elementary level, or elementary kids that are just learning the alphabet. So you have to be very specialized and provide multiple layers of support. Most of our kids come from a background of trauma and abuse and neglect, and they all need something therapeutic to kind of get them through, which is what we feel our job is. Our teachers are very dedicated and motivated, so we're not just dealing with the academic components, we're also dealing with the trauma and the abuse. So our teachers go through very specialized training in how to get these kids to feel safe, to open up, to start to trust people again. And that's when that happens, that's when you can actually start the teaching process. So it takes a very special person to work in our centers. We have paraprofessionals and think just like a regular school would, and we try every day to make an impact. The cuts in the RTF grant funds may seem like a drop in the bucket, you know, compared to some of your other budgets, but for us, you know, as a small facility, I'll say at Hillside, that budget is 41% of our total operating budget. So it would be devastating. We're not talking about textbooks or materials and supplies, which we have to beg for. We're talking about actual teachers sitting in a classroom. So I would appreciate your support and not cutting. Don't take away our money.
Good afternoon. I'm Juanita Stedman. I'm the executive director of Together Georgia. Prior to that, I was a juvenile court judge for 16 years in Cobb County, and it has truly been a privilege for the last 2.5 years to represent these folks. And they were the folks who came in front of me in a courtroom who I consider boots on the ground. Make it not go anywhere, because I need to give you a job offer. Because I had a millennial when I was a judge for 16 years, and I don't have anybody like that anymore. So Macon, if you're looking, you could just ride in the car with me and I'll just give you my phone and you can do with it whatever you want to do. There are a lot of challenges to these schools, and the challenges are there because of the children that they serve. The one thing I think that we have to all remember is that they're Georgia's children. They're Georgia's children because they really don't have parents. Many of them don't. They come to these centers and they may come one day and they may disrupt and be gone the next day. Or they may come and they may be there for 30 days if they're fortunate. And I will tell you that as a judge, the most difficult children I placed into these residential treatment centers. They were the children that kept me awake at night. They were the children that any judge on the bench that's on a juvenile court bench will tell you that you wake up at night and wonder not just what's going to happen with them tomorrow, but what's going to happen with them that's going to result in them being able to not be in prison, and for them not to be trafficked, and for them not to be homeless. And as I often say, and if you see me again, you'll hear me say this, you pay for it now or you pay for it later, because that's what happens. And I'll give you an example of that, because as judges, you know, people always say, oh, Juanita, you have such funny stories, and every judge does have some funny story. But I'll tell you a story about Michael. Michael came to me when he was 10 years old. He had been arrested. For the first time and the only time on my bench, the campus police officer who had brought him there cried because he had been told he had to bring him to court. Because everyone knew that Michael was emotionally disturbed. Michael was one of 5 siblings that were adopted together. And what we later learned was that the other 4 siblings and his parents stayed in a bedroom every night with a bolted door because they were afraid of 10-year-old Michael. Now, I think a lot of Michael's trauma was because probably at 7 and 8 and 6, Michael had been a parent to those other siblings. He had suffered the trauma and he had been a parent. So I worried about Michael, obviously. I fretted about Michael, but I was fortunate enough for Michael to go to Hillside. And when Michael went to Hillside, we would have 30 and 45 day reviews. And when we would come back, Michael was in school. Michael was being educated. Michael's parents, his foster parents, who were the only parents he ever really knew, cried every time he was in a courtroom because they wanted Michael to come home. Michael was not going to be successful at home. And he certainly was never going to be successful in a regular educational setting. So Michael went into a specialized foster home and continued in that education setting in Hillside. And we all have those stories, but what happens is this. Because of that, Michael got an education. Because of that, Michael has a job. And for all of us, because of that, Michael is paying taxes instead of being someone that we're using taxpayer monies to pay for. So, yes, I'm very passionate about these schools, and I had no clue about what non-QBE meant versus QBE. I barely knew what QBE meant, except that I knew that from my own little system, school system of Marietta City Schools. But what I do know is that any cut, to cut one of these schools 41%, is significant because the school systems cannot educate Michael. And if there's 770 kids in these schools, or if there's 800, or if there's 650, they're all Michaels in some way or the other. So I urge you, when you're looking at this budget, we certainly will come and talk to you and talk to some of you individually, but to really look closely when we're talking about cutting and making a cut. One of the concerns I have is this. When you look at that cut, the Department of Education made a cut of the number of school days these children would be in school. That cut wasn't made by the local school system. It wasn't made in conversation with our schools. It was made, I guess, as a budget cut. And I may not understand that, and I know some of these DOE people back here, and they'll grab me and try to educate me, and I get that. But these children need every day of school that they get. They need more than every day. So I urge you, after I hire Macon, but I'll wait till you're finished with your session so you won't really be mad at me. But I really urge you to look closely at this and to ask us questions about it, because these are the children. They're your children. They're my children. They're the children of the state of Georgia. Nobody else is going to take care of them other than you. And this committee and other and the House Representatives Committee, that's who has to take care of them. So I urge you to do that. So thank you very much, but come find me, I'm telling you. Thank you. Thanks, y'all. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, there's a couple of questions for you. Representative Stovall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for the presentation. I was curious as to, I'm assuming that your funding is coming from I guess because you're not a traditional school, so I was just curious about how your funding is allocated. And that was the question. How is your funding allocated? And I know it's based on the FTE count. So I just
is.
Since you all are not, like I said, a traditional school, I understand it, but
we
I was
are
wondering
we
how
are.
You all are done.
So we earn QBE dollars that are funneled through our local school systems. And then we also have the Residential Treatment Facilities Grant, which is the non-QBE that we're talking about now. And that is to cover the local share, which we don't get to participate in for the local school systems. But we do also get Title I and like neglected and delinquent and that type of funding.
And I would also add that many of us being nonprofits reach out for charitable dollars to help supplement that as well, which maximizes and leverages the opportunities that we have for the children in our care.
Thank you. Let's see, is that Becky? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Thank you. And I know when you and I had talked at the Education Appropriations Committee meeting, you were telling me that the high school students maybe were staying in a less amount of time, but it was due to insurance. Is that right? So do all of your children, are all of the children in your facilities on some type of health care from the state? And do you receive those healthcare dollars too, or how does that work? And why was it that younger children can stay longer and older children can't?
You might be able to answer this a little more in depth. For us at Hillside, anyway, our younger children tend to be more of the children that are in state custody, so they're funded through Amerigroup, which is the privatized Medicaid model or whatever. Whereas our older children, a lot of them are placed and are using private insurance funds, but we take all different types of funding, so it's different for every child.
And I would say in our organization, we have 120 kids, and three of them are privately placed kids.
Right.
So the better part of them are state kids that are there. With the experience that we're having, Price Academy is listed in that spreadsheet, is that with the Families First Act, the state of Georgia is not placing as many children under the age of 12 in congregate care or child care institution settings. They want them in foster homes. So that's been a change for our school. And so we've gone, our FTE numbers and our average daily attendance has gone down. The funding was based on average daily attendance taken when it was 13. Well, now I have 23 kids. That's 10 kids more because we have no control over admission and releases. And so to have that level of funding significantly below what we are open and able to care for is a concern. And I hope that answered your question about the front.
One thing that we have suggested as a group is to just maybe hold this harmless, not do anything with it, and let us as a group meet with the Department of Education this summer and look at, is this funding formula working? Are you truly comparing apples to apples? You know, should it be looked at in a different way instead of doing this cut that will certainly harm them for the next year and not be looking at what we're what's really out there and what's really happening?
So I'm sure you've been in contact with Chairman Dickey and
yes,
Chairman
we met
Dempsey
with him yesterday.
And Chairman
yes.
Dempsey.
Yes.
I'm sure both you're across all of those.
I have their cell phone numbers and I know how to use them.
Here, here. So. Yeah, we are all good at that. Yeah. Is there a way, I'm just curious, just for me, is there a waiting list for people to go into residential?
We have a waiting list generally.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's part of when you have your psychiatric care places like a Hillside and Amerigroup, it has to be a medically necessary placement. So yes, there's a waiting list.
Yes, where are those people at in the meantime? Curious.
The real answer is some of those kids are in hotels. And you know that, and you hear about that. Some of those kids, because there's not anywhere else for them to be placed, and they've been in 10, 12, 13 different placements that they've disrupted, they may be placed in a hotel at the cost to the state, and that's through the Department of Family and Children's Services.
Okay. And just lastly, I'm just curious, now that y'all did the God's work. I mean, there's no, I don't think, I can't imagine. I mean, but so how finding employees? I mean, what are they? I'm a curious person, but what training do they have? Are you finding have a hard time locating people or what?
It's extremely difficult. For me, I have a population turnover probably of teachers, maybe 40 to 50% every year, and I have to start with brand new people because our teachers are not necessarily paid on the same pay scale as the local school system. They don't get the teacher's retirement. They're not on the state benefits plan. So while they may love the kids and what they're doing, it's kind of greener on the other side. And so they'll leave us for a few years and realize, you know what, I miss working with these kids. And they might come back. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. My teachers all have to meet the same state criteria, so that part's easy. But I think with the direct care staff that you may be referring to, most of these guys are fresh out of college. They're coming to us with criminal justice degrees, sociology, psychology, those types of things that they really need to kind of get their feet wet, see mm-hmm. what they want to do, and then they're going to have to go back to school to have, you know, back to school to have a career. So they're pretty young, and the turnover is very high. These kids are awesome, and they're a lot of fun, but they will also burn you out pretty quickly.
Oh, yeah. Any other members? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sir. Representative Hill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have just one question, please. Who sets the time limit on these kids, how long they can stay there? Because I'm sure you'll see somebody like little Michael or somebody who needs an extra so many days under your care. Who establishes that time frame?
That can really be twofold, and I can give you an example as with Michael. I have decided that maybe I was the meanest judge in the whole state of Georgia now that people are coming back and saying, because I would set the time limits. I would say he's not ready. Some judges can't and won't do that. Maybe I was just older and have been around longer, but often it's set by where is the next placement. You know, where is that child going to go? If they're there through insurance, if they're there through state insurance, then the time limit often gets set, and I think not correctly so, but often gets set by folks who aren't treating the kids but are insuring the children. I hope that was a politically correct way to say it.
Judge, I can also...
you know, there are all kinds of other pressures to get kids back with home, back with family, and those types of things. And sometimes those are on somebody else's timetable. Nothing frustrates me more when they say, okay, Charlie's going to court tomorrow. Oh boy, they sent him home. And you're right in the middle of a school year. You know, it's sometimes crazy. We've had kids go to court not knowing they were going home, and we never see them again. We get a message to pack their bags up, and we never got to say goodbye. I will say, though, at least in my district, my school district, Bibb County, Dr. Curtis Jones, when I had some kids that were getting ready to get moved to a different placement, and I picked up the phone and called him and said, Dr. Jones, are you willing to make an exception to our agreement? The foster parent is willing to drive these kids to and from the Methodist home because we're in early April, and they need to finish through May. Will you make an exception to our local agreement that these two kids can stay in our schools, finish their grades, and then start next year? And he said, absolutely, without question, whatever's right for those kids, we're going to do it. So we've got some good folks out there who really do care about where our kids are educationally, and we'll step out in that way.
Okay, we are up against 3 o'clock. So,
thank you so much.
Members, there are some of y'all have questions, I see, and I think Ms. Carter, Matthew, they will not have asked a question after we adjourn. But we're adjourned. Ways and Means, as Chairman Harrell is, look at him, breathing down my back.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies.